I knew God was with me. I always used to pray. My prayer was I asked God to not to let the devil kill me out here while I was in the streets before I could get back. But I said, if you give me one more chance at life and music, I promise you, I'm going to shout you out.
You are now tuned in to Prevent the Event.
Good evening. How is everybody doing out there tonight? We're glad to be back with you once again. So I think we have what is going to be an interesting show tonight. We're going to talk about hallucinogens, okay? And then once we talk about that in general, we're going to get down to some specific items. But before we do that, I must ask the individuals that are co-hosting the show tonight. We've got Dallas in the studio, we've got Jeremiah in the studio, and we actually have special guest Miss Ida in the studio as well. So let's start with Dallas. Tell me, how was your holiday season?
It was really good. I got to see family and friends, and I had a good time.
Okay. Did Santa Claus bring you everything that you wanted for Christmas?
Just a little bit.
A little bit, okay.
Just a little bit.
Okay. What about you, Jeremiah?
It's been good. You know, there's been stressful points because, you know, school, I had to get some school stuff done. But even outside of that, you know, it's nice to see family, get away from the stressful nature, we're all kind of just relaxing. So overall, I kind of enjoyed my time at home in this holiday season.
Okay, so did your school actually have, you're a college student, right?
Yes.
So did your college have a specific time set aside for the holiday, or is that still going on, or how's that working?
We have a specific two week break. It actually ends this upcoming Sunday. So the next time I'll be back on there, I'll be back in school. I think that's for most people. I know some friends who are going back on the 15th, which I'm like, okay, how did that happen? But yeah, it's just these 2 weeks have been really kind of just for me to get away from it all, decompress, and kind of reevaluate myself and kind of reevaluate school and everything else as well. So it's been really necessary to have these 2 weeks off.
Okay. And if I make no mistake, DPS is still out too, right, Dallas?
Yep. Okay. We go back to school on the 8th. I know some of my friends are going back tomorrow.
Oh, okay. So they were what, charter schools or other types of schools or DPS?
I think part DPS.
Hmm. Okay. So parts of DPS.
Okay. So I again look forward to DPS actually getting back in, because there's some business that I have to take care of as it relates to being able to go into some of the schools and deliver some of this information as well. So we've got to set up some appointments, and obviously can't do that till they get, you know, open back up. But in the meantime, what I want to do is circle back around to something that we were talking about before we took a small break. The last time we were here, we were talking about depression, and we were talking about, you know, how the holidays bring on some or trigger, you know, depression and things like that. So how did that work for you? You didn't experience any of that, did you, Dallas?
Not really. Mm-hmm. I'm glad that I didn't, because I was really happy on Christmas Eve. I got to see my best friends and regular friends at our Christmas party that we had at our house.
Okay. So speaking of friends, you've got a friend in the studio today. You want to give her a shout out?
Hi, Chelsea.
Well, sorry, didn't mean to put you on the spot like that. But again, how about you, Jeremiah?
I'm going to be real honest. I did for a little bit, but I think it was just due to stress and a lot of compounding factors. And I think it got to the point where it's kind of out of your control, so you get kind of paranoid about it. And it's like, I can't do nothing about this, but, like, I kind of need to do something. It was in that weird gray area where it's like, I did my part, and now it's out of my hands, but it's kind of like it's in my hands still, so I was in that state for a couple of days. But I think, like Dallas said, being around friends, family, I was at a friend's birthday party for her 20th. She celebrated that, so I was able to get around, see some old friends. see some family, see some cousins I haven't seen in a while, and kind of connect with a part of my family I haven't connected with for a while, like my siblings. So I think allowing that also kind of allowed me to relax myself and kind of, it kind of brought me back to earth a little bit. And I kind of had the point where it's like, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't. The only thing I do from that is kind of just rebound from it and improve from it. So that's what I would say for anybody listening and how I would say go on from here on forth. But yeah, it was a struggle for parts, but it even is a struggle now. But you know, you kind of got to take it day by day, week by week, and kind of just hope and just kind of make it better over time.
Okay. So I'm just going to be transparent, not only with you all in the studio, but those that are listening. I personally, mentally and socially, I pretty much had a great time over this holiday season. There was an unfortunate incident whereby I learned that one of my former students, and I will say one of my former students at Weber Middle School, actually passed away. So I don't know all the details. I don't know all the details, but it just kind of reminded me that this season that we're in, sometimes, whether it be depressive or, you know, anything like that, it sometimes can not be a good place. The individual did reach out to me, but unfortunately, I got the message like, you know, an hour and 47 seconds, which that's going to stick with me for the rest of my life. Okay, that time, an hour and 47 minutes, was just not long enough or enough time for me to get in touch with that student. So another question that was asked of me that kind of falls into play is that one of my fraternal brothers, he asked me the question. He said, "So what happens when someone like you who talks to other people, who do you talk to when you have challenges?" You know what I'm saying? And my response was, I talk to people like you. I talk to people that'll listen, because you just never know where the next good idea or something that will calm your soul comes from, you know. So again, to kind of close that particular conversation out about the depression and about the holidays, I encourage that if you have anything or anyone you need to talk to, make sure you kind of reach out. If there's anybody here or listening that needs anybody to talk to as it relates to prevention or treatment, you can always, I'm going to invite you to call me. My number, you can reach me at area code 313-868-1340, and just ask for Mr. D. And you know, that's pretty much during the week, and if you need any assistance, I'll be more than willing to give you my opinions and what I can do to help you as it relates to a resource for you. Having said that, what I'd like to do is I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Joshua here.
And right, Jeremy.
That's right, Josh. Where is Joshua? I'm gonna call him out on the radio too. I'm sorry, Jeremiah. All the J's, I'm all messed up. I'm gonna turn it over to Mr. Jeremiah so he can talk to us about some hallucinogens, and then we're gonna get very specific as it relates to a hallucinogen on this Prevent the Event on radio show this evening.
Okay, yes, like Mr. D said, today's radio show episode is about hallucinogens, and then in the next half hour, we'll be talking specifically on LSD as well. So if you're probably thinking, like, you've heard LSD before, like you heard what it is, so then what's the broader term in hallucinogens? Well, hallucinogens are found in plants and fungi or any synthetical produced, and are among the oldest group of drugs used for ability to alter human perception and mood. So, you know, like acid, mushrooms, shrooms, you know, like the main ones you can think of. And mostly it's like what you imagine it is how it affects the mind, the perception. There's a picture in our document of the Mad Hatter, and the phrase that's like, oh, it puts you in Wonderland. You're not really aware of what you're doing. You're not really aware of what's happening. We're gonna go more in detail after this, but I'm gonna start it off with a little story I heard. My grandfather told me a story about these fraternity guys and their initiation. My granddad didn't do it. He just happened to see it. He happened to know about it. And these guys, as their, this is a legitimate thing, as their initiation, they were given mushrooms and then placed underneath the floorboards of the frat house, and then the frat house had a party on top of the floorboards. So imagine your perception is altered, you don't know what's going on, and they put you underneath the floor and have a giant rave on top of you with the strobe lights, the loud music, the loud noise, and you have to come to and be like, yeah, I want to join this fraternity. I'm so excited. That is horrifying. I couldn't imagine. And that's truly the effects of it. The guys were like depressed. They were horrified. They couldn't even tell you what they saw. They thought they were dying. They thought they were buried alive. Mm. So that's just the effect of what the perception can do to you. So the origin, like we said, can come from laboratories. I mixed up two words. Laboratories, and are found in plants. So I'll swing it over to Dallas. What do they usually look like? And what do they usually look like?
Little pills.
So yeah, little pills. You know, they come in various types of colors and tablets. While LSD is usually like a blotted paper. So like it kind of looks like a stamp, which we'll talk more about in a later part of the show. Hallucinogens are usually in a pill form with a colorful graphic or design, so like a rainbow, a smiley face, a triangle. One of these on here is literally the Warner Brothers logo. So things like that to give you that colorful aesthetic to it. So, you know, like we said, there's a lot of psychiatric effects on the mind. It allows you to see and hear things differently. It affects your mind. Mostly it is like, have you ever been to a party and there's those strobe lights going on, those crazy colors, and you imagine everything slowed down, but the lights were a lot faster, the lights were a lot brighter, but you slowed down. You don't know what's going on. It's just like everything slows down, but the lights are brighter. It's hitting you harder. It's like you're going blind. It's affecting you. You can't see. You can't breathe. It's affecting how you feel. And that's usually the impact it has on you. It affects your mind, which ultimately causes the effect on your body, which can go down a lot of crazy things. So we talk more about the effects on the body. And Dallas, I want to ask you this question. We're going to go back to that fraternity story. With these psychedelic effects happening on a person with like high heart rate and increased blood pressure, dilated pupils, what would you think in a situation like that would be something that could be happening to a person who may be experiencing that? Like, what do you think could be going through their mind? What's the main thing you think is going through their mind in that moment?
What's happening?
Or this old saying, am I dying? You know, for most people, when we all have that sharp pain in the chest where it's like you're breathing wrong, and it's like, oh my God, I think I'm having a heart attack. It's like that feeling.
Heartburns.
Like the heartburns, you cough, you keep coughing, it's not stopping, or you breathing, your chest tightens up, and you're just like, oh, am I dying? That's the effect that hallucinogens can have on your body, where you may not necessarily be dying, but because of the sped up heart rate, your dilated pupils, your blood pressure increasing, your mind's moving faster than your body, you start to realize that you might be dying. You thinking that you're having a heart attack. You're thinking that everything is going wrong. Everything is bad is happening to you. So what are the overdose effects? Well, the main one is death, because it is a very potent drug. So death exclusively from an acute overdose of LSD or magic mushrooms or any of those drugs are extremely rare. So it's very unlikely you'll see someone overdosed on said drugs or said hallucinogens. But here's what it does cause death in. Most of the time, death can be caused due to dangerous behavior or due to a person accidentally eating something very poisonous or dangerous. And it could end up causing a lot of dangers to the body overall. So when you think, in worst case scenarios, sometimes taking these hallucinogens could cause a person to take their own life. And any other severe overdoses as well could cause seizures, you know, respiratory arrest, or anything like that. So I'll swing this question to you, Dallas. Why do you think it is so you think people are driven to potentially ending themselves or going into these strange, these dangerous behaviors due to this drug? What do you think is, why do you think they go through that?
People are more likely to commit while they're doing the drug because it's just so much to endure and it's pressuring them, and the only way out is committing.
Yeah,
that's what I think.
Yeah, it can, it's that, and there's also, I'll put this in perspective, Dallas. Imagine you just have constant thoughts running through your head. It's never stopping, it's never ending. It's like you don't know where it's coming from. It's like everything is fast, but everything's slow, but your mind's fast. You can't breathe properly. You're thinking it's never gonna end. I'm like, it's happening in slow motion. That's usually what the main cause is. So I'll have you read this for me, Dallas. What is their legal status in the United States? Could you mind reading that for the audience out there?
Many hallucinogens are Schedule 1 under the Controlled Substances Act, meaning that they have a high potential for abuse. No currently accepted medical use and treatment in the United States, and a lack of acceptance safety for use under medical supervision.
So, to put it short, sweet, and more easier, swallowable terms, it shouldn't be used, and the only time it's probably ever going to be used is in a medical supervision. We talked about this weeks ago in a show about opioids, where it's very common to get it, but it's only ever really used in a medical sense because it's in a controlled environment, and the people who are usually prescribing said medications or said hallucinogens are there because they know what to do in those situations. And the reason why it's in Schedule 1 of the Controlled Substances Act, mostly 1, 2, it's like it's multiple levels to it. If you're in 1, that means don't take this. It is a good chance something really bad will happen to you if you take this. Hallucinogens are in 1. We'll talk more about LSD and what it is due, because that's usually the one people mostly associate with it besides mushrooms. So I might as well swing this question to you, Dallas. What do you think people should do if you encounter someone? What's the main thing you think they should do if they encounter someone potentially having an hallucinogenic episode on some drugs? What's the main thing you think they should do?
Try to help them, but don't be too aggressive, because I know people like that can be like really hostile. So you have to be very calm and collective and try to get them in a dark room alone and just leave them there to collect themselves and like have them drink water or try to make them throw it up. Like,
you were close until you said the dark room alone part. You kind of don't want to lead them to their thoughts, but you also don't want to leave. You don't want to be too surrounded around them. You want to, the first thing you want to do is call 911. Get someone there immediately, and they'll talk to you over the phone how to go about it. Everyone's heard the term of a bad trip, right? Everyone's heard that term. A bad trip. Okay, so Dallas shaking her head. A bad trip means, in slang, you took a drug and it's affecting you a wrong way. It's having a bad effect on you. Well, someone say had a good trip means the opposite. If you took it, you felt nice, and you had a good trip. You don't want to have someone have a bad trip. And what I mean by that is they may be already feeling as if it is happening. You don't want to be that proverbial metaphorical nail in that coffin. You don't want to be like, hey, let's get around them. Let's shake them, make sure they're okay, because they're going to react bad. Their mind's already going through a lot of things. So if you go up there shaking them, going like, hey, are you okay? Are you okay? You don't want to do that. You want to stay as calm as you can be, because you don't want them to go manic or have a radical episode. You just want to call 911. You want to maybe give them some water, like you said. Just try to not be close, but not be too far away, and just try to make sure the person is okay, that as soon as the medical professionals are there, they're all right as well. But I'll ask Miss Ida a question, since she has been sitting here, and I don't want her just to sit here and feel like she's not belonging in this.
Absolutely not. I'm enjoying you.
So when we think about the idea of people taking hallucinogens or eating mushrooms, the bad kind, of course, why do you think it is so popular for people to take shrooms or taking LSD or taking any other hallucinogens or like mind candy? Why do you think it's so prominent in your mind?
Because
It's just your personal opinion.
I just can't fathom it. I don't understand why people feel like if you take drugs, you know, you're going to have a positive outcome. After time after time, you see the outcome is all of these things that you just mentioned. You know, none of these side effects are nice side effects here. You know, I don't see anything where I had a ball. It made me feel giddy. It made me feel, you know, made me be able to respond better, interact with my peers better. Everything associated with it, as far as I know, is a negative association. So the only thing I can think is peer pressure, misconception that society puts on drugs, you know, for monetary gain, you know, it's not anything positive, in my opinion. Why they take them? It's more of a to me a seduction, like they seduced you into it, you know. They pressure you into it.
I get that. Also, one that I think I thought was very stupid. I thought, I was like, there's no way that's true until I really thought about it. You just might have ate the wrong thing. Now, you're probably thinking, what, Jeremiah? What do you mean by you just ate the wrong thing? You don't just put random stuff in your mouth. Well, mushrooms. A lot of mushrooms have different effects in different people. There are good mushrooms. There are bad mushrooms. The way it grows, the way it colors, the way it grows out, the way it reproduces. Scientists have gone through the whole thing. Some people legitimately will go out in the forest, be like, oh, I've eaten a mushroom before. That's a healthy mushroom. And they'll take it home, they'll grill it, and they might release poisonous spores in the air. Boom, you're sick. Or boom, you don't get sick, but you don't hit it now, but you eat the mushroom, and now suddenly you're sneezing. You can't breathe. Legitimately, with mushrooms, it is like, real talk, do not go out and just pick your own mushroom unless you are very, very, very aware of what you're going to eat. Because at the end of the day, mushrooms are fungi. They are bacteria that has been growing off some little, usually off of some other dead living organism. So what you kind of don't want to do is go out there, pick up a random mushroom. Like, oh, I've had a mushrooms in my pizza or in my spaghetti or like any other pasta or any other meal. You're like, man, I've had like this. It looked brown there. I can have it now. That's not necessarily the case. Yeah. And that will end up causing a moment where you may be having hallucinogenic episodes along that. So,
well, unfortunately, these hallucinogens that we're talking about, I wish they were something that you just stumbled on in a park, right, or in a forest, that type of thing. But these hallucinogens, the fungi and things like that, is they've been manufactured just to cause these adverse effects. You know what I mean? It's not like you just stumbled up on it and it's just part of nature and you were exploring. You know, that's totally different.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, there is manufactured drugs, which a lot of drugs are manufactured. You know, I've seen people with the small baggie of the small mushrooms, like, hey, have a shroom. See, people say, have a shroom, which I'm going to be honest with you. If someone hands me a small baggie of just dried up mushrooms, that alone should tell you not to take it. But I say it's a lot of effects it have on the body. Obviously, in the next conversation, we'll have about LSD, which is more specific and probably the most known one. But before I send out college, I will just end off with what is their effect on the mind. And this is very true. Sensory effects include particular disorientation that vary with dose settings and mood. Psychic effects include disorientation of thoughts associated with time and space. Time may appear to stand still and form an LSD powder and capsule color seem to change to take on new significance. Weeks or months after hallucinogens have been taken, the user may develop an unknown disorder called hallucinogen persisting precipitation disorder, or HPPD, or experience flashbacks, which means you're having flashbacks in the moment you took it as well. But that's just what I want to leave it to you. I'll bring out the number. I'll get a correction if I'm wrong because I haven't said in a long time. It is 871-6095. Yes, I'm correct. I haven't said in a long time. 313-871-6095. If you want to call in, ask us questions, give us comments, or just talk with us as well, we'll be happy to do that to you as well. So we'll give it a couple minutes to wait for any callers, and then we'll send it to a song break. But yeah, these are the effects that HPD can have on a person. It can cause a lot of flashbacks or effect on the mind. So really take account of that.
Yeah, and when you talk about hallucinogens and you're talking about young people, a lot of times you're not gonna hear the word hallucinogen.
Yes.
You know, you're gonna hear the word acid,
shrooms, LSD,
cubes, fried. They've got all these nice, cute names that the harmless names that make it more intriguing or enticing. You know, sounds less dangerous. You know, they even call it mind candy. You know, Special K. When I was coming up, Special K was a cereal.
Oh yeah.
You know, it wasn't hallucinogens, you know. So we have to, we really want to make our children aware of these sort of tricks, you know, and that's what they are, you know. They're synthetically produced. That means it's nothing, it didn't come from nature, you know, so that's a red flag right there, you know. And our young people need to know that, you know.
Yes.
They definitely need to know that there's no good thing that's gonna come out of using hallucinogens recreationally if you're not under the care of a doctor or something of that sort.
Yes.
It's an illicit street drug.
Dallas, you got any last thoughts on just hallucinogens as a whole? Just any last comments you wanna talk about that? Okay, so if we happen to get a caller, we'll answer them after this song break. If not, we'll once again wait until end. We'll wait for a caller at the end. But we'll take you to a quick song break. Once we come back, we'll talk about a specific hallucinogen, which is LSD, which is probably the most known and commonly used one. And we'll see you after the break, where we'll talk more in detail about that. We'll take you off for the song break.
This song is for those that know without a doubt in their mind, I made it out all right.
Yes, so we do have a caller. Sorry to cut y'all off on the song, but we do have a caller. Hello.
How you doing?
How you doing today?
All right. I was listening to the station, and I don't know if it'll be off topic, but I wanted to kind of throw some knowledge out there about something that's close to my heart, and that's drinking and driving.
Yes. Do you have any? You want to talk? Yeah, like you want to speak more on it? We'll give you the floor.
Yeah. I recently got a DUI. Mm-hmm. And it's not my first one, but, you know, I wanted to kind of touch and tell people, you know, with everything that's going on out here, you know, you got to be really aware of how it's being marketed and packaged. Something like what you was talking about with the mushrooms and any other drugs that's being sold by the state, which is that word loosely, because you can go in the store, just say any gas station now. You can walk around that gas station, look for your potato chips or your pop, but the brightest thing in the store that's most lit up is the alcohol. Because that's what they're attracting you to, buying that alcohol. Then when you overconsume, that's when you get pulled over by the police, and now you have put yourself in a lot of trouble. You got to start off with, you might go to jail, which 9 times, you know, even if you go overnight, that's time spent. You can end up getting all these fines. You can lose your license. And the whole thing of, it starts off as fun. You know, you start off having a drink. Oh, okay, everything is sociable. Next thing you know, you done had too many. And with the new laws, you can technically get a DUI driving under the influence of one beer.
Well, I'll allow Mr. D to talk more about it because he's more experienced about that than I am.
Well, I don't know about how much more experience, but the first thing I want to do is say thank you for calling in and sharing that knowledge with our audience, and it's very much appreciated. If you have anything else that you may need assistance with, you know, we're here to help you. And matter of fact, my direct phone number is 868-1340, and just ask for D, and we'll go ahead and take care of you. And if there's any other assistance you may need, or if somebody you may know may need, feel free to give me a call, okay? That's 868-1340, okay?
Okay.
All right, thanks again, appreciate that. We're gonna turn it back over to the staff here.
Yeah, we kind of cut you off of that music break, so we're gonna let that finish out that one song, and then we'll come back and we'll start with the other program as well. So we'll let that song play out.
Great is your
welcome back to Prevent the Event. So, correction, I said effect earlier that I want to correct myself on. For hallucinogens under the Schedule 1 of the Controlled Substance Act, meaning that they have a high potency for potential abuse, there is no currently accepted medical use treatment in the United States. So I had to just correct myself on that because I had made a mistake earlier with that. I don't want to give anyone here false information. So just want to correct myself on that before we head on to our next topic, which is on a very specific hallucinogen, which is LSD. So I'll ask Dallas, if she doesn't mind, can you read what is LSD?
Lysergic,
yep.
LSD is a potent hallucinogen that has a high potential for abuse and currently has no accepted medical use and treatment in the United States.
Well, yep. So if we want to use, so like hallucinogens, there is no medical accepted use in the United States. So the same would go for the thing that's underneath the category of hallucinogen, which is LSD. I'm going to try to read the full name of it because I, Dallas, friend of me, I think it's lysergic acid diethylamide. That last word is the part, I think it's diethylamide. I don't know, if I mess the word up, someone will correct me one of these days. Or unless Miss Ida, unless Miss
Dithalamide.
Wow, I did so good in chemistry when I was in high school. But what is the origin of it? So most of it is produced in laboratories in the United States. So the most common known street names are like, you know, acid, dots, mellow yellow, not the soda, and window pane. So what does it usually look like? It's odorless, it's colorless, it's a colored substance with a slightly bitter taste. You know, it's usually available on saturated absorbent paper, like blotter paper divided into squares, with decorated squares, and each square representing one dose or tablet or microdose, or saturated sugar cubes, or in liquid form.
Yeah, and when we were on break, Dallas, you were saying that you've never heard of LSD. You know, that's an old term. You know, we were saying that's an old term. they've come around since the 70s. That it caught on really heavily back then. So acid, dots, mellow yellow, and window pane. Have you ever heard any of those terms amongst your peers?
I think I've heard acid. I think acid is probably the most commonly used one I've heard. It's like something like you're tripping on acid. And I think that's the most commonly one word I've heard used for it. I don't know if Dallas has heard people say the word acid.
When I hear people use the word acid, I think of like they're talking about a drink. They weren't really talking about.
Oh, like, yeah, fair. That's fair.
Mm-hmm.
So it's usually abused orally, which means through the mouth. Most people would just place it on their tongue and then let it dissolve and then swallowing it back, which is usually how most people do it because it is an absorbent colorless paper, so it dissolves a lot when in water. It will dissolve when wet, so just dissolve in the tongue, people will then swallow it. And then the effects will kick in. So before we go more into the facts, Alex Dallas, do you want to just read some quick facts off about LSD real quick?
After taking the quote-unquote acid, this was from what somebody was saying, I imagine that we had driven head-on into an 18-wheeler and we were killed. I could hear the screeching metal and then a dark and evil quiet. I was terrified at this point and I actually thought we were dead. For a year, I wouldn't go into any cemetery because I was terrified I would find my own grave.
Yeah. Dallas has a book. Like, the information I have in front of me is from the Department of Justice Drug Enforcement Administration, so the DEA. So, like Dallas saying, the effect on the mind, she gave a victim's testimony of it. This is the DEA's actual scientific statement of it. So during the first hour of ingestion, the user may experience visual changes with extreme changes in the mood. While under the influence, the user may suffer impaired depth and time perception accompanied by disoriented perception of the shape and sizes of objects, movements, colors, sounds, and touch, and the user's own body image. Mostly, everything's going to be wonky to them. The way things feel, the way things look, the way things, you may touch something that's soft and feel like pins and needles. You might feel every little thing happening, like the victim's testimony. It felt like you had a head-on collision with 18-wheeler. And they were saying, we felt like we heard everything. Usually, if you hit an 18-wheeler head-on, you're dead on impact most of the time. So for them to be able to say, even though we died, I felt like we heard everything happening, that's the effect that something like that can have. You feel like you are feeling and hearing everything. Everything's sensitive. Everything's touchy. So, and to continue more on that, the ability to make sound judgments and see common dangers is impaired too, making the user susceptible to personal injuries, like we said about hallucinogens. Most injuries and deaths caused by hallucinogens are self-harm effect. So most of the time, person could get themselves injured by just going out and doing something crazy that their mind usually wouldn't do. Or some kids, people will straight up will take their own life because of hallucinogens causing that as well. And like we said earlier, taking LSD could end up causing you to have HPPD, which is hallucinogen persistent perception disorder, which will cause you to have certain flashbacks to certain events while you're with drugs. And it could even happen weeks and months after you had taken the last dose. So
physical effects that can happen when you also take the drug is dilated pupils, higher or lower body temperature, sweating or chills, also known as goosebumps, loss of appetite, sleeplessness, dry mouth, and tremors.
Yeah, it's like the whole thing. It's everything. Everything is weird. Nothing feels right on you. You feel like everything. You feel like if
like you want to rip your skin off.
Like, I don't want to be like graphic with that, but it really feels like that. Nothing feels right, and that's where you usually end up causing those self harm injuries, because you don't know what's wrong, you don't know what you're gonna do. Nothing at all seems normal. So I'll bring it back to that story about the fraternity. You're in that state of mind, and you're underneath floorboards, and these parties happening. People are stomping, screaming, yelling. These lights are happening above you, and you're stuck in this tight space, and all this is happening, and your mind is just racing, and your perception of time is that it might be going. It might feel like it's taken 4 years, and the party might have lasted maybe less than an hour. That is the power of hallucinogen and LSD can cause on the mind.
Yeah. Just as a disclaimer, you know, we're not saying that LSD is associated with fraternities.
We're not saying that. This is a story. Yeah. We want to clarify that. Yeah, this is just a story. We're not bad mouthing no fraternities. We just want to clarify that.
Yeah. But a lot of times on college campuses is when young people are introduced to these kind of drugs, or any drugs and alcohol, in settings where it's the first time they're home, they're not with their parents, you know, they have to make their own judgment calls and things of that nature, you know, and so sometimes those experimental situations come in, and unfortunately, people use college campuses to prey upon our young people. So, we really have to do our due diligence as parents and adults to make our children aware, you know, ahead of time of these type of pitfalls. You know, because they're everywhere, not just in a fraternity. Anywhere where there's some children gathering, there's some youth trying to be positive and make their way through life, you're gonna find somebody somewhere is gonna have some predatory behaviors. You know, so
yeah.
You know, we just have to be aware of that.
Our job with the show is to be honest and factual and not putting on anyone, but to be honest. And that isn't the statement. Whenever we say a story or a topic, we're not saying it's always them. I want to clarify that for future reference in case someone clips out that part out of context. we always want to be honest with you. So to talk more about the overdose effect, so like longer, more intense trips, like we said, can cause a lot of psychological harm. And it can end up causing a lot of effects on the person's mind even after it. We talked about in the last month about mental health. Well, taking LSD affects your mental health greatly and includes inducing a lot more fear responses, depression, anxiety, paranoia, and can be long-lasting or a thing that will just continue popping up. Death after LSD use is rare, so LSD is usually not the immediate reason for why you die. Most of the time is due to self-harm or the effects that LSD had, not the drug itself causing you death. So I want to make that clarification. It's not the drug itself that will kill you. It's usually the effects or the aftermath of you taking said drug. And
your mind, the fact that your mind is playing tricks on you. And, you know, it caused you to walk out into traffic or jump off of a... those things that you see on television, you know, in movies, that's pretty much reality when you're on LSD and these hallucinogens, you know. And they're, in my opinion, when you see it in movies and things like that, for young people, it kind of numbs you a little bit. It makes you less of... leery about it, you know. It's kind of like it's numbing you up. You're not as where you wouldn't try it. You know what I mean? So that too, that's another opportunity for a parent to talk to their children, because we don't want to get desensitized when we're seeing this on television and they're going on this LSD trip and. They live to tell about it, or you know, they tell, I went on that was a bad trip, or that was a good trip, or no, you know, those people end up either in the hospital or dead. You know, there is no 30 minutes later I get to talk to you and tell you, you know, the effects that it had.
It's
on
crazy
me.
Because yeah. Usually it says that LSD, when you take it, it typically lasts to 12 hours. So imagine feeling like that for 12 hours. You already spent 8 hours in
madness.
School. That's
yeah, and also like Dallas said, it's 12 hours. But like, it's not the 12 hours that really gets you. It's what happens after the fact that really gets you, or what you're doing in the 12 hours that is not necessarily the drug's fault. Like we said, usually death from LSD itself is not the reason why these people end up unfortunately passing away. It's usually due to just the effects of overdosing or taking the drug itself. Which drugs cause the similar effects? Well, LSD effects are similar to any other hallucinogens like PCP, mescaline, or I'm gonna mess up this word, psilocybin. I want to maybe correct me. Is it
phylloxin?
Melusin, and then.
Mescaline
and I'm actually gonna pronounce this word. It's a P word. If anyone out there knows the word, don't know what I'm talking about.
Psilocybin.
Yes.
Psilocybin.
We're gonna go with that for now. If I'm right next episode, I'll correct myself. But like any other hallucinogen, it's in Schedule 1 of the Controlled Substance Act. It should not be taken. There's no medical use for it in the United States. And it's very likely that if you take this, you will start to abuse the substance. So the main thing that LSD hallucinogens have is, I want you to take away from this, is like, the drug itself is not going to cause the harm. It's what your mind causes. And it's ironic we're doing this after the mental health episodes we had during the holiday season, because we talked heavily on mental health and how that could cause. Much of us don't realize that drugs and mental health, or alcohol and mental health, usually go hand in hand with most people. Some people will get sad and they'll go to drink their sorrows away. For them to get that happiness back, they might go smoke weed. And for some people to get out of reality, they might unfortunately take a hallucinogen, which could end up in a sad way, causing them to having a bad outcome. So it's what I would say is this: mental health and these drugs go hand in hand. And as you see from LSD and hallucinogen, they have a very, very strong impact, not necessarily on the physical aspect. Yes, you have high, you'll get a high, your blood pressure will increase, your heart rate will increase, you'll start wheezing, you might start vomiting, you might start throwing up, your mouth will be dry. But it's mentally what's happening to you. It feels like what that person says. You're in a car crash, but you feel everything. And I want that to really nail home for the people who are listening at home. Is imagine you got in a car accident and everything slowed down and every single inch of pain happened one by one by one by one by one. That is what hallucinogens and LSD can cause on the mind, which can cause the effect on your body, which sadly can lead to someone passing away.
Feel like you're getting tortured.
Yeah, for a possible up to 12 hours.
For 12 hours. It's usually, yes. But yeah, like the, yeah, like the 12 hours, it's horrible. After that, it can be worse because of HPPD, which is that flashbacks and those feelings of like, you feel like you're going through it again, but you're not. What I would say, maybe, I would say is always seek medical attention. If you feel like something is happening in your mental mind, you can always speak to a counselor, a psychiatrist, a therapist. Get the help you need, even after effect. Be honest with them to let them know that you did take a substance and it is causing this effect in your mind. There is not a necessary cure to it, because it's kind of hard to judge a cure, but there are treatments and ways to get the help you need from having these hallucinogenic episodes and taking these drugs to make sure that you don't have your mind overflow with bad thoughts or having things like that. And the main way, swinging it all the way back to last month, is make a self-care checklist and like Ms. Ida says, being aware of your surroundings and being aware who's being predatory, who's not, who's a real friend, who's not. So absolutely, that's what I would mainly say. So we're almost done. So I'll swing it over to Dallas to give her last thoughts on it. Ms. Ida to give her last thoughts on it. And then I'll have my last thoughts on it and we'll send y'all out. So Dallas, I'll start with you. What's your last thoughts and statements for people out there listening?
I just think that, I just think that it's a really rough thing to go through, because even though I haven't taken a hallucinating drug before, I have hallucinated before because of hot water. It can overstimulate your brain. And so I was hallucinating. It is not fun to go through at all. I was crying the whole time. It felt like I wasn't even there. I saw a bigger me and a smaller me, and I was like in a black blanket and I was running from my bigger self. And then when I came back, I almost hit my head on the shower because I was falling, but I didn't know I was falling. And when I got out the shower, I was just crying, and then all of a sudden I saw boats on the wall, like, you know, those cartoon boats and like the little waves and stuff. That's what I saw. And then I had to calm down, and then everything was black. And I woke up the next morning, like everything was normal. But imagine that, but you're actually being hurt. Like you're actually being stabbed, but you're not. You know what I'm saying?
Imagine it being more prominent, more like it feels like you're
internal.
Dying. Internal. It feels like you're dying. Not like you just got hot, not like a hot flash. It's like, oh, it's too hot, I'm gonna pass out. It's like, no, like, this is bad, I can't do it.
Like, but you're dying, but you can't die. You're being tortured. And yeah, there's no way to stop it.
It reminds me of PTSD, you know, when you're reliving that trauma over and over and over again. When it talked about having the flashbacks, some of the residual effects of it. You were saying that there's no cure, there's no treatment, did you say?
There's no real, exact cure to it, but there is treatment that you can do.
Yeah,
And we would say NCADD has the treatment for you if you find yourself in situations where you've experimented with drugs, you've gotten in over your head. Call NCADD, 313-861-1340, and we have specialists there who can help you and give you the guidance that you need. Call
313-861-1340. Wait, I think we have a correction in number.
So if they need assistance outside of here, 868-1340.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yep, she was right.
868-1340.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay.
Yeah. That's the NCADD line.
Yep. And what I would say as my final words, because I don't want to take too much left of y'all time, is if you want to learn more about it, always check NCADD. But the paper we have in front of us right now is from the DEA, Get Smart About Drugs. Go to getsmartaboutdrugs.com and learn more about that yourself. Teach your kids, teach some families. But it was nice talking to you all. We're so glad you got to spend your second day of the new year with us. We want to wish you all a happy new year because we didn't see you yesterday. And continue on your journey, learn more about stuff, and get better at that. We wish you all a safe rest of your holiday season, and we can't wait to see you next Tuesday. Bye-bye.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. See
y'all.
Happy
New Year.
I knew God was with me. I always used to pray. My prayer was I asked God to not to let the devil kill me out here while I was in the streets before I could get back. But I said, if you give me one more chance at life and music, I promise you, I'm gonna shout you out and I'm gonna testify and we're gonna have a little church up in there.
Oh, 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 I'm blessed.
Waking up, thanking God. Every day is feeling just like Sunday. Wifey fly by my side. Green light, everything is going my way. Riding clean, living dreams. Just left the barber and I'm feeling like Midas. Heard him say, give him praise. What's in the water got you acting like this? In a day go by that I don't try to thank the Lord up above. And if you wonder why I'm loving life, I'm close and I tell you what's up. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, playing cards, laughing hard, barbecuing, waking up the whole block. Music loud. Turning out, little kids are breaking out the bus stop. Life is good, really good, and every moment, no, I can't forget. I gotta say, I won't change. You're the reason that I am like this. Ain't a day go by that I don't try to thank the Lord up above. And if you wonder why I'm loving life, come close and I tell you what's up. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face.
We've missed you. Welcome back to the family. Gospel.